Whether you know it or not, we've all seen someone who's suffering from schizophrenia. Because the truth is, 1 in 100 people suffer from the illness. In other words, it's quite likely that at least one person in this room has or will develop schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is most easily characterized by its hallmark symptoms, delusions and hallucinations. Delusions are false beliefs, things like thinking the FBI is following me and out to get me. And hallucinations are false sensory perceptions, like hearing voices or seeing things that aren't there. Luckily, we're just starting to tap into ways to reduce the burden of the illness and, in some cases, prevent it altogether. And preventing the illness is exactly what I'm interested in doing. Now, schizophrenia has a large genetic component, but an equal contributor to the illness is one's environment. For example, social interactions greatly affect the course of the illness. Patients who live in a stressful family environment are more than twice as likely to relapse compared to those who live in less stressful family homes. So for my dissertation, I became interested in studying how social interactions like that affect individuals who do not yet have schizophrenia, but are high risk for the illness. These are folks who are starting to have early rumblings of psychotic symptoms. So more specifically, what I did was I brought high-risk individuals into the lab and exposed them to stressful social interactions, as well as positive praising interactions, and compared their physiological, their body's stress responses and mood responses to individuals who do not have any psychiatric difficulties. Now, as it turns out, no one likes stress, and the high-risk individuals are no different from anyone else in that regard. And then on the other hand, the high-risk individuals were very responsive to the positive social interactions. They really soaked up those interactions, and their body's responses and their mood responses came down to levels that matched their healthy counterparts. It was also the case that the high-risk individuals were much lonelier than their healthy counterparts. So it seems like overall, on the one hand, or overall, they're in need of positive social interactions, and when they get positive social interactions, they really benefit from them. Now, so much of my field has looked at reducing stress, what we call reducing risk factors, and that's definitely important. But the other side of the coin, positive factors have largely been overlooked. And based on my research, positive factors like positive social interactions are so beneficial for those at risk for schizophrenia. Now, in the world at large, people are constantly connected with everyone else, but the truth is people feel lonelier than ever, and this is even truer for those at risk for schizophrenia. To remedy this, finding ways to increase positive social interactions, increase connectedness, can be one major ticket in our success in reducing these folks' symptoms, helping them grow to their full potential, and maybe even prevent the illness altogether. Thank you.